Hello everyone and welcome to the iSystem webinar series. Today's episode is about continuous integration session 2, utilizing on-chip tracing in continuous integration. In our first session, we discussed the basics about integrating iSystem tools into a CI environment. Today, we will include on-target trace recordings to measure, for example, CPU load or code coverage. We will start with some theory about trace, CPU load, and code coverage, and then show in a live demo the integration of these metrics to the CI process to enable the tracking throughout the whole development phase. My name is Sabrina Kisslinger. I'll be the moderator today. Today's speaker is Matthias Scheidt, who will lead you through the technical presentation. Hi, Matthias. Good to have you here.
Hi.
With his expertise in the development of hardware-related software components, Matthias supports our team as systems engineer. In this role, he works on improving our products. And currently, he is focusing on solutions to integrate the iSystem tools into continuous integration environments. So that's it from my side. Over to you, Matthias.
So welcome also from my side. Let's start with a look at the agenda. The first part will give us an overview of continuous integration. We see how embedded targets can be integrated into a CI and check out the iSystem Connect SDK. In the second part, we introduce on-chip tracing, show up debug and test scenarios, discuss CPU load, and see how an operating system can be profiled with tracing. After that follows a demo where we integrate a CPU load benchmark in a CI system. Let's start with an introduction to continuous integration. CI is a software development practice where the team members working on a software frequently integrate their work products. This could be application code or test code. The key point is that each integration triggers the automatic build and test. The figure shows a developer that performs a code change, and from that point where the code is in the loop, build and test procedures are started, test reports are generated, and in the end, we have software that is ready to be delivered. The practice has many benefits. Developers get instant feedback whether a code change is causing any tests to fail, breaks the build, or is fine. It allows you to keep your code base clean. For example, if tests are failing, the code change won't be merged to the master branch. And every code change is built and tested in the same environment. Developers can focus on developing code and don't need to maintain test setups on their local machines. Since CI is a common practice also for embedded software projects, it is required to integrate on-target tests into CI. So how can on-target tests be integrated in the CI? There are different tools available for CI, like Jenkins, GitLab, GitHub Actions, TeamCity, and so forth. They all share the concept of pipelines. A pipeline is a series of automated steps to efficiently build, test, and deploy the software. These steps are executed on so-called executors. Sometimes also the term agent is used. The example pipeline consists of several stages. At the begin, it performs a checkout. It applies some static checks. We have a build stage, perform several tests, and as a last step, it deploys the software. In order to be able to perform on-target tests, the executors of the test stages, which can be dedicated or virtual machines, or also containers, need access to a debugger. For that purpose, we have our iSystem Connect SDK, which can be used to automate the required tasks in WinIDEA. iSystem Connect SDK is our software development kit. It provides an API to fully automate the iSystem tool landscape so that interaction via the user interface is not required anymore. The high level of abstraction allows the reusability of your automation implementations. Your scripts can be shared for different target CPUs or across different projects. It has native support for Python. In the root folder of your WinIDEA installation, you can find a Python distribution that already has installed the iSystem Connect SDK. But it is also possible to download the SDK from our homepage or install it via the PyPI package manager. Other languages that are supported by the SDK are Java, C#, and MATLAB. On our homepage, we provide a very detailed documentation and a huge example library that covers almost any use case. Now we come to the introduction to on-chip tracing. On-chip tracing is an advanced debugging technique that allows us to observe the activity of a CPU. To support on-chip tracing, the hardware requires a dedicated on-chip trace logic. So not every hardware can be used for this. This trace logic can be configured to generate and stream out trace messages. The trace messages contain timestamped events of interest. Depending on the supported features of the on-chip trace logic, different trace techniques are available. Program flow trace generates trace messages for program flow instructions that are executed by the CPU, like call, jump, return, and branch. Data trace generates a trace message when the CPU performs a memory access, for example, when a variable in a certain address range is read or written. There's another technique called instrumentation trace, where the application needs to write output data to specific register. This can be seen as a low latency alternative for printf style debugging. Program flow and data trace are non-intrusive, which means they do not affect the runtime behavior of the system in any wise. On-chip tracing opens a broad range of opportunities that would not be possible with conventional methods. With program flow tracing, it is possible to measure the code coverage without instrumenting the affected source code. As long as the trace data was streamed out and recorded, complex bugs can be analyzed even if the application running on the target has crashed. Timing analysis and profiling allows to check for timing constraints. CPU utilization on multicore systems can be optimized, and complex temporal correlations can be investigated. With additional OS awareness, it is possible to completely track the tasks. They can be visualized in a timeline. You can see when the task was running, how long it stayed in the waiting state, and so on. A metric that can be measured with on-chip tracing is the CPU load. The CPU load indicates how much time a CPU is doing actual work inside a measurement period. So in other words, the CPU load is the proportion of time the CPU did not spend for idling. The value can be calculated by dividing the time the CPU spent for execution by the measurement period multiplied with 100%. Or by 1 minus the time the CPU spent idling divided by the measurement period multiplied with 100%. In this trivial example, we have an idle task and two additional tasks. We take a measurement period of 35 milliseconds. So there are two ways we can calculate the CPU load. We can sum up the execution times of task 1 and task 2, 5 milliseconds for task 1, 10 milliseconds for task 2, another 5 milliseconds for task 1 is a total of 20 milliseconds divided by 35 milliseconds of the measurement period and multiplied with 100% is 57.1%. Or the alternative way, sum up the idle times, 5, 10, 15 milliseconds, 1 minus 15 milliseconds divided by 35 milliseconds multiplied with 100% leads to the exact same result. So we can calculate the CPU load if we know how many time a core spends executing the idle task. But how do we know how much CPU time a specific task consumes? Most operating systems are using structures in the RAM to store some management data. Data like the ID of the current running task or interrupt service routine. So whenever the scheduler is performing a task switch, there is also a write access at that specific location in the RAM. Having an embedded target that is equipped with an on-chip trace logic, supporting data trace, we can observe the relevant location. The blue box sets up the trace logic to observe the location where the US stores the relevant data. Every time data gets written to that address location, the trace unit emits a timestamp trace message that reveals which data was written to that location. The analyzer in WinID is capable of interpreting this data and can provide profiling timelines, statistics, and so on. Of course, this is a very simplified view, but you get the idea of it. Now it's time for the demo. We will use the following setup. We use WinID, Python in conjunction with the iSystem Connect SDK for automation, and Jenkins as the CI tool. On the hardware side, we use a Bluebox 5700 that is connected to an Infineon Aurix TC399XE via AGBT Active Probe. In the demo, we will use on-chip tracing to profile the CPU load, automate the procedure with our System Connect SDK and integrate everything in the CI pipeline. Let's start. The workspace is already loaded in WinID. We open the analyzer and expand the view. By clicking the hammer icon, the dialog for the active configuration pops up. In the dialog MCDS, which stands for Infineon's Multi-Core Debug Solution, we get an overview of the current configuration. MCDS uses so-called processor observation blocks, or in short, POBs for trace. Here we have three available POBs, and each one has assigned a CPU. POB X sees CPU 1, Y sees CPU 2, and Z sees CPU 0. When we switch to the configuration of a POB, we see that the config consists of actions, events, and triggers. We don't want to go into too much detail here. In this configuration, data trace triggers are configured to addresses of operating system data structures, in this case for Core 1. The triggers are assigned to events, and the events are assigned to data trace unit write actions. Whenever data is written to the address range of the US structures, the microcontroller streams out trace data. POBY observes the structure for Core 2, and POBC observes the structure for Core 0. The profiler is configured to analyze all relevant data objects and is also aware of the US objects, like configured tasks and interrupt service routines. If I start a new analyzer session and run the embedded target, trace data is recorded and the analyzer provides a detailed timeline which gives insights of what actually happened inside the microcontroller. tasks can be expanded. It is even possible to see the state of a task at any given time. You can zoom in to get a more detailed view. Since the profiler knows which task was active at a specific time, it is possible to calculate CPU load values for each core. Therefore, we use the post-process feature CPU load. Enable. The period seems reasonable since we have a 100 millisecond recurring task. And in this area, we need to select background and idle tasks. Now the analyzer shows us CPU load values. We can click on the timeline to get the exact value of a specific point in time. Let the profiler adjust the zoom. We can notice some kind of peak here. And by opening the properties dialog via the context menu, it is possible to get further statistics like average, max, and min values. In our continuous integration demo, we want to process this data outside of WinIDEA. For this purpose, we can use the export feature of the profiler. It is capable of exporting the profiler data to different file formats, like XML. For our demo, here we are interested in statistics. This is an example export of the profiler that contains CPU load data. It has all the required information, like CPU name, the average value, the min value plus the additional timestamp, and the max value also with the timestamp. Now it's time to integrate the profiler into a CI pipeline. We run a Jenkins server with one active project. And to save some time, the first build of that project was already triggered. The initial clone of the Git repository took almost 4 minutes. In the project configuration, we can scroll through the current pipeline script. At the top, we define the path to the Python distribution that comes with WinIDEA and has a pre-installed iSystem Connect SDK. The clone stage is used to check out the project sources from the Git server. And we have two exemplary stages called build and static check, which have no real purpose in this demo. Back in the project overview, we can see this configured pipeline steps. If we trigger the build again, it should be pretty fast, since Git does incremental fetches from the server. Yes, the pipeline completes immediately. Now we want to enhance our pipeline in a way that it is capable to automatically measure the CPU load our software generates on the embedded target. This script automates the measurement procedure by controlling WinIDEA via the iSystem Connect SDK. It downloads the binary to the target, runs to the main function, manipulates a global variable which affects the CPU load. I will get into more detail regarding this variable later. It creates a profiler controller object and starts the profiler session. After that, it runs the target. We wait for 3 seconds. Since the profiler session is limited to 2000 milliseconds in the configuration, We then stop the target, create the export configuration object, configure which information is exported, in this case we limit it to the data objects, we don't need the timeline, and finally we do the export. This script needs to be executed in our Jenkins pipeline. We need to enhance the pipeline script in the project configuration. We add a new stage block and call it on-target profiling. In this stage block, we need a steps block. And here we add a batch command. We call the Python distribution from our WinIdea folder. And the script Python shall execute is in workspace, scripts, automate profiler.py. Double check it, apply and save. When we trigger the build, the new pipeline stage appears, and in the background, now WinIdea is controlled via our Python script. The profiling procedure on our embedded target is executed. It will take about 20 seconds. I will trigger another build and bring WinIdea into the focus to show how the automation works. The binary is downloaded to the target. A trace session is started. The CPU is put into running state and trace data is collected now. And if we browse to the workspace files, we can see the exported file here. For the evaluation of the CPU load data, we use the Jenkins benchmark plugin. It allows to compare Boolean and numerical results over the history of builds. The plugin comes with a threshold mechanism to control the build success or failure. For this demo, we will use the default JSON schema, which is documented in the benchmark's GitHub repository. It uses groups that have assigned tests as a child element, and results that include the unit, the value, and also the thresholds. To get the benchmark plugin working with our profiler export data, we need to convert it from XML format to JSON format. We can do this with a Python script using the following steps. The profiler export is passed. Namespaces are defined. XPath is used to extract the required data. And note that we are extracting the max value of the statistics. We do this for core 0, core 1, and core 2. Once we have extracted the required data, we are setting up the JSON structure. A group is needed. We call it CPU load tests with a short description. We create a test that also has a name and a description. Then we add the test results. The unit is percent. We assign the value we extracted above, and the threshold is 50%. We repeat this also for core 1 and core 2. Assign the test to the test group. and the test group to the root object and dump our JSON output into a file called benchmark.json. The script takes the profiler export and converts it into a JSON file format that the Jenkins benchmark plugin is able to read. The next step is to automate this conversion as part of the pipeline and make Jenkins aware of this benchmark data. I add another stage to the pipeline by copy and pasting the previous stage block, adapt the name to benchmark. The Python script that is called in this stage needs to be changed. It should be convert XML to JSON.py. The benchmark plugin provides a pipeline step command that I'm going to add now to this stage. The important input parameters are input location and schema selection. Default schema means the plugin will interpret data according to the schema documented at the benchmark plugin's GitHub repository. The other parameters are required by the plugin, but empty values are fine for our use case. Now we apply and save the pipeline changes. And we are landing on the project overview page, where we can trigger a build now. Pipeline run for build number 5 is executed now. As in the previous runs, the on-target profiling stage will run for about 22 seconds again. But once this is done, I expect the new benchmark stage to show up as well. And yes, here it is. Success. If we reload the project overview, this link to the benchmark tables appears. The tables contain a detailed overview of the results. Core0 has a maximum value of 33.6%, Core1 a value of 27.6%, and Core2 about 20%. All values are highlighted green. The reason is that all tests have passed since none of the values exceeds our threshold of 50%. To check if the pipeline is working as expected, we will increase the CPU load on purpose in the next steps. We can achieve this by modifying the global variable by CPU load skew setting in the profiler automation script before the CPU load is measured. Several applications on our embedded target use this variable as an input parameter. A higher value of this variable leads to a higher CPU load. We need to commit the change to the repository and trigger another pipeline run. Although we can expect higher CPU load values on Core0 and Core1, the increase of the skew variable from 25 to 35 won't generate enough CPU load to exceed the thresholds. However, it is a good indication if our pipeline is working, and it demonstrates how the benchmark plugin keeps track of the values for every build. When we check the benchmark tables, we can see that the value for Core2 is not affected by the change, but the value of Core1 increased from 27.6% in build 5 to over 33% in build 6. And the value of Core0 increased to 46%. All values are green again. All tests have passed again. Let's work on this. Now we increase the skew value to provoke a failing test. Let's set a value of 70. Commit the change. And trigger a build again. If a threshold is exceeded now, which is what we expect, the result of the pipeline run should no longer be success. The build should be labeled as unstable and the color indication will switch from green to yellow. Here it is. Let's go into the details. Core0 now has 2 passed tests and 1 failed, and the same applies for Core1. All tests for Core2 are passed, If we check the values in the upper table, we can see that values of chord 2 are green. Chord 1 and chord 0 are green for the previous two builds, but red for the latest build. It is possible to get even more details by clicking on the value. The chart shows how the CPU load increased over the last builds. There are some additional statistics and also details for the selected build. We can see that the status is failed and the statement is the value 70.07 is above the maximum of 50. Since I don't want to end this webinar with a broken build, I will set the skew variable back to its initial value. Set it back to 25. And commit the change. And while it's running, we can use the time for a short recap of the past 30 minutes. We started with an overview of continuous integration, learned how to integrate debugging tools into pipelines. We did an introduction on on-chip tracing, CPU load, and in the demo, we set up a CAI pipeline that uses on-target tracing to profile the CPU load. Since our build is fine again, I want to thank you for the attention and hand back over to the moderation.
Matthias, thank you very much for your demonstration and for sharing your knowledge with us. And thank you for ending the demo with a working build. This is much more easier, nicer, let's say nicer, than the broken build. As I already mentioned, we will have a Q&A session, and during the Q&A session, you can download the presentation by clicking the cloud symbol top right of the screen. So, no questions yet came in, so please, everyone who has questions, feel free to raise them. Until then, Matthias, I would like to discuss a little bit about your demo. You used an IC5700.
Yeah.
And how did you connect the blue box to PC?
So there are two options to connect the blue box to the PC, USB or Ethernet, and Trace can generate a huge amount of data in a very short time. Since USB has higher bandwidth compared to Ethernet, it is the better option for trace use cases. Of course, it depends a bit on what exactly should be traced and how much trace data that will generate, but as a rule of thumb, use the USB connection for tracing. So the short answer to your question, in the demo, the Jenkins host had a direct USB connection to the blue box.
And on the other side, the RX TC399 XE target board was connected. Yeah. Is this demo setup or this example also working with other microcontrollers? So for example, a PowerPC or
yes,
a Trivia 2 as a Cortex-M.
Yes, the RX was just used as an example. So you can integrate any device that is supported by WinIDEA. The automation of the target is controlled with the iSystem Connect SDK. And this is very generic and independent from the hardware. Of course, if you want to use on-chip tracing in your CI, like in the demo, you need a device that is capable of doing tracing, but it's not dependent on the hardware.
Cool. So not only trace is, of course, supported, so basic debugging functionalities can also be integrated in such a CI environment. Okay. Correct. And just to recap it, you said if you want to use trace, of course, you have to have the trace pins available. There are also microcontrollers out there. Let's stick with Aurix. They are called production devices, which have not the trace pins available. In such a case, a so-called emulation adapter can help. So this is a solution to desolder the production device, put in amount of a small tower with a measurement board, and then on top, the big emulation device is available, and then everyone can reuse your demo for a known setup.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Let's come to the platform. you used for the CI. You used Jenkins. There are also other platforms existing as GitLab, TeamCity, or so. Is this also working with those or only with Jenkins?
No, so it's also working with those. The integration of our tools into CI is not limited to Jenkins. The feature that tracks the metrics for the builds was provided by this benchmark plugin, but all major CI tools on the market I'm aware of are capable of importing custom metrics, like, for example, the CPU load. So you can use your preferred CI solution, and they should also be able to track any value that you get out of the analyzer and see the impact of your code change build for build.
Cool. So in all ways, generic regarding a microcontroller and regarding the CI platform.
Yeah, for sure.
Nice one. You mentioned just CPU load, and you discussed CPU load during your demo at the very beginning. I also mentioned code coverage analysis. Could you tell us a little bit how that would work?
Yes, you can also measure code coverage. For code coverage, we use program flow tracing. So you need a hardware that is capable of doing program flow tracing. And the analyzer records the trace data, calculates the coverage out of it, and is able to export the results to an XML file. Most CI tools require the Cobertura XML format per default. We provide an XSLT file to transform the iSystem XML format to the Cobertura XML format, and that way you're able to integrate the coverage data from the analyzer also into a CI system.
Cool. So a lot of use cases are possible, from complex trace, CPU load, or code coverage analysis to simple debug functionality. So I think this is quite a versatile solution to get a better performance into your software.
Sure.
All right. We have no questions still, and I have no questions left. Matthias, I'm happy. Then I would like to come to an end slowly. Thanks again, Matthias, for sharing your knowledge.
You're
Thanks
welcome.
For answering the questions.
Thank you.
And before everyone is leaving, I would like to give you some additional information. Please leave us your feedback in the post section. This helps us improving our webinars continuously. Check out our online tutorials as the generic win idea or the more detailed trace tutorial, and also our YouTube channel where this webinar will be hosted and others are already available. For example, continuous integration session 1, the role of hardware debugging tools. Stay connected with us. Give us a like on LinkedIn, on YouTube, or just register to our classical newsletter. Feel free to do that. And if questions come up after this webinar, feel free to send us an email to webinar@isystem.com or reach out to your sales or tech representative. Bye, everyone. Thanks for attending and take care.
Bye. We'll be right back.